the Sky News Centre. This is Paul Murray Live.
Happy Sunday. Thank you very much for watching wherever you are around the country. Thank you very much, Corey. We will see you again this time next week. Of course, yesterday was Remembrance Day. I hope you had the moment to pause at 11 a.m. or otherwise, like myself, pay attention to the sheer number of Australians that have served their country since Australia had an Air Force, an Army and, of course, a Navy. I was checking the stats from the census back in 2021, so these are the latest numbers we have. Did you know 581,139 people who are living amongst us today have served or did serve? Obviously, the number is a great deal more over the decades and more than a century, of course, since the formation of Australia as the modern country it was in 1901. Of those, more than 100,000 lost their lives. We commemorate them on two significant days in Australia. One is the declared public holiday, that is Anzac Day, where we focus in particularly on the efforts in World War One. Remembrance Day is, of course, the end of the Great War that was supposed to end all wars. But as we know, the Second World War and multiple skirmishes or outright conflicts Australians have been involved with in the many decades since. But the reason for pause is that 103,000 people have lost their lives for this country. Now, these were people who chose to join or were forced to join by their government, but their deaths are all equally important. From the Middle East all the way through to back in the Middle East in Iraq and Afghanistan, from East Timor to training incidents which have happened here in Australia. For obvious reasons, we pause, we don't forget. And at the ceremonies that were taking place all around the country, the people who are part of that, more than half a million who are among us, who have served, either currently, recently, or a long time ago, they all pause. They wear the uniform to remember their mates. They wear the medals to remember their service. We pause to thank them. And as easy it is to say that we will remember them, the reality is that do we remember what they fought for? This is obviously a theme we'll get to in a moment's time. But to any and everyone who has got somebody in the Australian Defence Force that is currently serving, strength and love to you, to anyone who has served their country, my eternal thanks. I never take for granted that I'm able to exercise the ultimate free speech, that is to speak my mind as loudly as I do each and every evening, because the threats to such a country have been repelled by previous generations. I can't help but think what the generations that have fought for this country, died for this country, and still live amongst us as those that have served for the country, feel about where we are right now, particularly after World War II. Sadly, as the days roll on, the further we get away from the physical connection to our parents or grandparents or the people we knew who served in World War II. Of course, World War II was a direct assault on Australia with the Japanese bombing Darwin. And what I'm sure to this day still rankles some, Australia was at one point considering that if the Japanese did land in the north, well, we would retreat back to the base of Queensland, the Queensland line all the way across the country, and we would fight as we got closer to the more populous parts and the south of the country. But again, after World War II, our suburbs were changed forever with war service housing. That's my experience when my grandparents lived in areas where the streets were literally named after the battles or the generals or the VC recipients. As these people got together and formed their local RSL branches, formed their local churches, formed their local Apex, Rotary or you name it, social clubs, the people who met in bowling clubs, and people who created modern suburban Australia. I am a creature of suburban Australia. Suburban Australia with direct links to the family members who serve in Vietnam and the direct links to those who served and suffered out of World War II. The people who were part of the Australian Women's Land Army, the people who flew bombers and the other side of the world. So my sense of self is directly linked to the suburbs that the greatest generation created. The suburbs that are now slowly being subdivided, sold off to the highest bidder, or turned into unit blocks. It's why we talk about population being a continual change in our country and not always one for the better. The reality is that countries will always grow, they'll always change, and you're not going to have the same housing of the 1950s, 60s, 70s and 80s all the way into this, the 21st century. But the ideals, the ideas, what you fight for, what you believe in and what you believe community to be is something that we cannot let pass with time. We will remember them is not just something that's drilled into you as a kid to say twice a year. It should be an ethos for what you take into the debates of where our country is and where it is going for all time. Because people died for us to have the freedom to have those debates. Those debates that are increasingly more dangerous to have, and even our government seeks to censor on the internet to this very day. I will always honour my grandparents specifically, my wonderful stepfather and everyone that I know from uncles and other family members who serve. I thank you forever for it. And on this program, we will always try to view the future of this country through the lens of sacrifice that you gave. That's why we say lest we forget. It's why we say we will remember them. Which is why Australia has to draw a line under the garbage which is happening right now when people are trying to play out the feuds of the rest of the world on the peaceful streets that are here. Now, that doesn't mean that you don't have immigration from difficult parts of the world, but it does mean that the Australian government or state governments or local councils, when they start to see Australia trend towards echoing those fights, to stamp it out. Any form of extremism must be dealt with. More fashionably, the left say that this is all about the extreme right. There was even academics who believed that one of the seeds that leads towards right-wing extremism is fondness for occasions like Anzac Day. That is a nasty place to be. But as we know, as the difficulties continue in the Middle East, as Israel exacts revenge for what Hamas did to it, innocent citizens in Palestine are being killed. There's no question about that. Whether Israel needs to stop or when it stops will be a matter for them. But there are, of course, many amongst us who are rightly taking to the streets to talk about the civilians that are the consequences of both the Hamas attacks in October and the many weeks of retaliation. But what cannot be tolerated are the people who seek to foment hate, the people who seek to intimidate people because of who they are, what they cannot control, which is the faith that they have, the families that they are from, or in many ways, while you can control it, there's a reason why we live where we live, because it is a familiar and safe surrounding. It is disgusting when anyone defaces a monument to the people that I just spoke about, but that's exactly what happened in Melbourne, with people writing on those very sacred stones laid over the past 100 years with names etched into them through all of the conflicts to stop the genocide, to free Palestine, and then in the colour of blood, shame on Israel, USA, UK, Australia. Sadly, we saw on Friday, again, people who claim to be talking about the innocent refugees of the Gaza Strip, a place where it is incredibly poor, where the average civilian is 19, but still they take to the streets to intimidate Jews because they're Jews. Now, in their heart of hearts, do they want to kill the Jews? I would definitely hope not, but if they're willing to intimidate, why are they doing it? Well, of course, they're doing it because the response of state, local and federal government has been so weak. To say that you can come from wherever you want, you can believe in whatever God you want, but the laws of this land say you can't intimidate people under any circumstances, but particularly because of their faith or whom they are. Now, all of this that has taken place, particularly in Melbourne, was in and around the suburb of Caulfield. This is when those people decided to confront And one of the groups that claims to have some level of leadership or organisation over the different rallies that we see each and every week has come out and apologised to the members of the Jewish community who were being deliberately targeted for intimidation. They did so on the news last night.
We apologise to the Jewish local community that that affected their worship last night. There were other people who joined and we're not responsible for the chance that they made.
But the reality is that what effort is being done by the organisers who want to focus on the civilian suffering to make sure that the people who are making the chants, making the intimidations, are not welcome at the rallies? What effort is being made to make sure that when a sign goes up, it is torn down and torn up when it suggests the best place for the Jews to go is into the garbage bin? Now, again, one of the apparent reasons why the intimidation of the Jews happened in Melbourne on Friday was because of a business that had apparently been firebombed. You may well have seen the story on the news. You may well have heard people use this as some sort of justification for what happened on Friday. But the reality is, this has nothing to do with what is happening in Melbourne, and definitely nothing what's happening right now in the Middle East.
It happened after a Muslim-owned burger store was set alight, although police say they don't believe the arson attack was politically motivated.
And then we return to the subject that, sadly, we've talked about too much in the past week, which is why are the authorities giving guided tours to those who seek to intimidate? There was a ride for charity that started in the Muslim-dominated suburb of Lakemba, but then moved very deliberately to the eastern suburbs of Sydney, which, of course, is well known as being an area with a significant Jewish population. This, of course, was nothing other than an attempt at intimidation. Have a look at who's involved, but have a listen that the police gave them an escort.
And tonight, a ride is underway from Lidcombe, organised by controversial figure Zaki Mallah, once acquitted of terror charges.
To help in the cause, to raise some donations for them.
Police escorting the convoy all the way to Coogee.
Seriously? The police didn't turn around and say, OK, we'll take you from Lakemba, we'll take you to Auburn, you can go to Stratford, you can move to this certain point, but you're not going to go any further than this because it's pretty obvious why you want to go into the eastern suburbs. As other presenters have shown you, and the Sunday Showdown reported brilliantly, people holding up what was clearly call-to-arms flags, but the police told them that the great offence they were committing was because their elbow was hanging out the window, not what they were holding out of the window. This is the same brass. And it's not the men and women of the police force. It is the brass that turns around and says, we can't manage 1,000 people. The same authorities that say they deserve celebration because no one gets hurt. Why? Because no one is telling these people that they can't go and intimidate. In fact, they again got the police escort from Sydney Town Hall the days after the October 7 attacks to go on a 30-minute march through Sydney till eventually getting in front of the Sydney Opera House. Now, again, if somebody wants to take to the streets to quite rightly talk about the civilian populations of their family members and their cultural history, I don't have a problem with that. That is the free speech that we live with. But the same organisers that are willing to pop up, as they did after the Opera House protest, to say, oh, look, that thing was a media beat-up and it was 20 seconds and those people were not allowed, where are they in saying about these active attempts to physically confront, to physically intimidate a population? And giving them a police escort is a not-so-subtle message that they are sending, that the police, while they won't obviously approve of violence, are more than willing to help them with the intimidation. Again, I don't know why. Now, as you know, this stuff is happening all over the world. In London, hundreds of thousands of people decided to use Remembrance Day to again allegedly march on the behalf of the civilians, but there's plenty of messages in there that are nothing other than a call to war. Nothing more than a demand that Jews should be killed because they're Jews. Why? Because there should be an Islamic caliphate. One that has very clear opinions on the LGBT community, let alone women's rights. But I want to show you in particular something that happened in the United States. There have been protests all through New York. And the poison that is running around on TikTok is particularly radicalising the young left. Now, among this group were a bunch of school kids in primary school who left their classrooms late last week so they could go and march with, among others, people who said this. Now, remember, this is not about the civilians in Gaza. This is about the want to establish a caliphate where Sharia law would be what we are all judged by, and unless we were the most devout of followers, we would all be found guilty with very serious penalties.
And there is nothing higher nor more glorious than a martyr, and so we say glory to all the martyrs wherever they may be. Allahu Akbar. And the truth is, the Western world is a lie. To the members of Congress, letting them know that they will be prosecuted in criminal courts.
Lots of code in that. The criminal courts are not the criminal courts that currently pass judgment on the citizens of places like Australia. No, they would be criminal courts under Sharia law, where the punishment would be far more violent than anything that is handed out for even violent offences in this country. Again, I say for the 17th time, if you're somebody who wants to take to the streets to say that there should be some sort of a change in what is happening in Gaza, then free speech means that's okay. But if along the way you march beside somebody who's holding a sign saying put the Jews in the bin, or you hear a speaker who says something like that and you don't leave, or you don't tell the organisers that they have to come out and not just denounce but declare that what that person said was wrong, then there's a bunch of people that are being used as some sort of Trojan horse here. That's why we need our leaders here to speak with absolute clarity about what is acceptable, which is free speech, and intimidation, which is not. And a failure to do so is a failure of our system to the extent where the police literally give an escort to people who seek to intimidate Jews as they move through the streets of Sydney, or the people who tried to confront Jews while they were praying in Melbourne. Another protest was when a ship which was coming from Israel was landing at a dock in Sydney. This was frighteningly organised by, in part, the union movement, who were more than happy to take up arms and scream as much as they could, along with a whole bunch of blokes who decided that their method of protest was to jump on the back of a jet ski and wave the Palestinian flag. Now, remember, the reality of these types of protests, if they actually do interrupt trade, the laws that have been put in place to deal with things like the blockade oil people would mean these people are going to spend some time in jail. Now, no doubt they'll be able to find a lawyer and a judge that'll say because they're upset about what's happening in the rest of the world, they should be let out. But again, these are the moments when the government says there is a line you do not cross. This is the defence minister of our country. This is the deputy prime minister. And when Airbus Albo is always somewhere else, he's the acting prime minister. Does this sound like a bloke who's speaking with all he's got?
And it's welcome that the Free Palestine movement have acknowledged that it was a mistake. I think it's fair to say that right now, Jewish Australians have never felt less safe. And that is a real problem, and we need to be moving to fix that. Clearly, you know, anti-Semitism doesn't have a place in our country.
Let's see what happens in federal parliament this week. The lower house is going to be returning, and let's see whether it all gets put into one box or whether the people who are actually being intimidated find support from their federal government. Let's see this week if we hear the Home Affairs Minister talk about what she's going to do about hate preachers, let alone what hate preachers are able to do online. Let's see if there's going to be a briefing from the Australian Federal Police, the Border Force, from ASIO, or are we going to both sides this, which is normally the way that leftist politicians like to deal with it. Remember the White House, they were asked specifically about anti-Semitism, the intimidation like what we just showed you out of New York. Yet her speaking notes flipped to Islamophobia. Now, again, Islamophobia, not okay. But whom is marching on the mosques? And if they did, I'd be equally as aggressive as I am about those that are marching on the synagogues. Compare the Defence Minister to the Shadow Defence Minister, and tell me which one you think really means it. Here's Andrew Hastie.
I think the government has to lead, and they have to give clarity to the Australian people about what is acceptable and what is not acceptable behaviour. We can't be mealy-mouthed about this. We have to be direct and clear. And for protesters to go into a suburb of Melbourne where we have a lot of Jewish Australians living and to impose themselves upon that group and to do it in such an anti-social and thuggish way is just unacceptable.
And another one of all of this mist that is around right now is, again, what the media chooses to cover, what it chooses to amplify, what it chooses not to talk about, and what it chooses to try to change the subject. This weekend, there was quite a deep and interesting read about neo-Nazis in Victoria. Of course, it was all about the far right-wing, Hitler-loving crazies, not the ones who agreed with the Nazis that the Jews should go, like many of the ones that were turning up at Caulfield. Pay attention to what the media talks about, but as always, more importantly, what they deliberately don't talk about. Meantime, something else that took place, which is even more significant than the blokes on the jet skis, was that many of Australia's ports are in real trouble right now. In fact, they've grinded to a halt. There's a big international company, it's actually owned in the Middle East, but it is called DP World. And DP World has had a cyber attack on it, which means Australian ports are basically locked closed right now. In fact, this company alone accounts for about 40% of all of the goods that Australia both import and export, and currently their storage facility isn't at 90% full because the containers can't leave the ports. Apparently, some 30,000 containers are currently held up, and it can be everything from crappy stuff for a discount store all the way through to blood plasma products. They operate ports in Sydney, Melbourne, Brisbane, and also in Perth. 10 a.m. on Friday is when their system shut down, and as best as I understand, that is still the case now. The expectation is that even with just a few days of disruption, let alone a full week of disruption, all of the stuff that gets imported to the country for Christmas and for Christmas sales may well be affected. Big news, we'll follow it for the rest of the week. Of all of the isms that we talk about sexism and racism, there's one I often refer to, which is ageism. It seems to be the ism that not too many people really fight about. There's not a day against it. There's no celebrity spokespeople. There's no ribbon. There's no hashtag. But the reality is that there are many older Australians who suffer directly as a result of ageism. In the workplace, it means you can't get a job. When it comes to aged care, as we've talked about before, tens of thousands of people that are complaining about what's happening in facilities or happening at home. But again, in the Channel 9 papers this weekend, apparently there's a thing called inheritance impatience, and this is leading to people abusing their family members. If you have a look at this line, it is the number of calls which people are calling to the Ageing and Disability Abuse Hotline. Now, you've got to imagine everything that happens before somebody actually picks up the phone and rings. But as you can see here, that the New South Wales Ageing and Disability Commissioner's Abuse Helpline received 14,000 calls last year. That's up 12%. And then have a listen to this. Of the more than 5,000 allegations about abuse of older people which was made to the Commission, the highest number related to psychological abuse. That's 41% of people. However, the Commission also received more than 1,400 complaints of pure financial abuse, including exploitation, misuse power of attorney and outright theft. Speaking at the Budget Estimates Committee of the Upper House in New South Wales, the Commissioner said that the trend was attributable to more people reaching the age of 75, i.e. people are living longer. For some people, that is elderly poverty, particularly single women, and a phenomenon referred to as inheritance impatience. Hurry up and die because I want your money. Our children, my children, will have to wait much longer for the wealth transfer to occur, and the wealth transfer has been pushed out by 5 to 10 years, says the Commissioner. What we know about adult children is they are not patient. So inheritance impatience will in fact grow. Isn't it amazing just how matter of fact that stuff gets said? It's not the lead story, it's not the front page. The first time you've heard about this data is probably right now, unless you happen to be reading the insides of The Age or the Sydney Morning Herald this weekend. that apparently people are now going to abuse their parents because they want their money. We've known that for some time, but now to start to have data behind it? I'm not entirely sure what you do about it. I'm not entirely sure how you stop it. But having information that it is happening at the level that it's happening is really important to see. And finally, about the world of education. Now, we all know that there are huge issues with education here in Australia. The performance of education in Australia is increasingly poor. Many of the factors behind that are, among things, the physical violence which is taking place in our classrooms, the lack of school discipline that exists. Remember, the OECD even put out a report that told us about the problems that are happening right now in terms of education in our schools. And this is frankly how we're failing our kids. Apparently, the lack of respect for teachers is one of the reasons why teachers bail. And even this weekend in the Australian newspaper, apparently teachers are now learning self-defence because of the violence that exists for some in some schools. So the American comedian Bill Maher sees the same trend happening in his country. So his idea is to set up his own Catholic school without the faith. He interestingly also points to some data about the number of kids who are in religious education who aren't religious.
You know, in 1970, only 2.7% of the kids who went to Catholic school were not Catholic. Now it's 22%. Yeah, Catholic school eighth graders are two full grade levels above public school kids because their school isn't a safe space for f***ing off. They're told, no, you can't be on your phone here, and your pronouns are shut up and sit down.
I love it. Good stuff. Quick break. Back with more. Looking forward to a big chat this evening. Andrew Bogart joins us with the Rogues Bogues podcast. But Stephen Conroy and James Ashby go through the events of the day, including how does Australia draw the line? How do we make sure that this weekend is as bad as it gets? As we truly stand by, we will remember them. More in a sec. Hey, I've got to sit up straight here. Got to get the camera right. We're all okay because it's my little girl, Zadie's birthday tomorrow. Turning the big six. Very excited for her. Her and her sister did very well today at their musical concert. Isn't there something amazing just about watching a choir of kids and just watching kids find their confidence on stage? It's really cool. Very proud dad I am, and happy birthday to you. Zoots, go to bed now if you were waiting to hear a shout-out from Dad. Let's get into the conversation right now with James Ashby, Chief of Staff to Pauline Hanson and One Nation. And, of course, the wonderful Stephen Conroy, who, well, he's a man for many seasons, but always for Collingwood and Football Federation Australia. Of course, Labor to his bootstraps. So, lads, you've heard what I've had to say about how we draw the line, where we draw the line, right? Now, I understand the complexities of the Middle East. I understand the imponderables and all the rest of it. But when we have what we saw this weekend in Sydney, where the police will help you, will escort you while you intimidate Jews, and we see people going out the front of the synagogues in Melbourne, Stephen, Parliament's back tomorrow. What do we need to see the federal government actually do? And do you think that they're just going to lump it in with a, well, extremism in all of its forms will fight it, or they're actually going to turn around and say, in Australia, you can march for the innocent civilians of Gaza or for Israel, but as soon as you start to intimidate people, including the way you're doing that, it's not on. The hate preachers, we're going to go after you. Do you think Claire O'Neill's going to say anything this week?
Well, look, firstly, can I agree with your sentiments? Absolutely. I mean, there is a legitimate right to protest, but there is a line at which the attempts to intimidate a broader community. I mean, I've got friends in the Jewish community in Melbourne who kids are scared to walk in the streets at the moment. And I mean, that is just, you know, fundamentally un-Australian. So I would hope that those who have decided to behave in that way reflect and understand that we have a very long tradition of protesting in Melbourne. We protest over many things that I've agreed with and I've disagreed with. But you don't do it in a way which is intimidating. You don't cause people who are engaged in religious observance to feel under threat and evacuate. I mean, can you imagine the reaction in some sections of the media, Paul, if, you know, that had happened outside a mosque? Yeah. I mean, the people would be up 100%. In arms, as they rightly should be. And so people should absolutely understand the difference between legitimate political protest and, you know, thuggish, intimidatory behaviour that is not acceptable in Australia. So I would hope that all of those points are made and that those who want to engage in legitimate protest understand that there are ways that they can do it that are acceptable, but also understand that associating with chants like from the river to the sea, if you want to march in a rally that says things like that, you are advocating the extinction, the eradication of the state of Israel. That is not Labor policy. It's never been Labor policy. People should understand that Hamas do not support Labor's two-state policy. They are absolutely an extremist and terrorist organisation. And if preachers across anywhere in Australia want to, you know, associate themselves with those comments, then that there needs to be, it needs to be addressed, called out and dealt with.
Yeah, I mean, but again, you know, James, as we're sort of, you know, supplementing different groups, right? If somebody tried to deliberately march and intimidate the Mardi Gras, we know how the media would react to that, right? But also in this in this scenario here, we've got to have a moment where, and again, sort of it gets said to me in a sort of offhanded fashion, oh, that's because there's lots of Labor seats with a significant Muslim population, so therefore they won't come out and talk about anti-Semitism. Seriously? Do they honestly? I mean, what is the logic there? What, that all Muslims believe some version of Hamas? Well, that's crap, right? The idea that the protection that need that would be offered to the Jewish community when there are equal examples for the Islamic community, well, you would hope that the government moves its rhetorical focus there. But again, tomorrow, when federal parliament's back, Claire O'Neill, now, no doubt it'll be all bluff and bluster when they're responding to an opposition question, then they'll get a Dorothy Dixer, but she's in charge of, and remember that hate preacher who was screaming about ASIO and all the rest, right? Well, she's the minister responsible for it. Where is she coming out and saying, this crap's not on? This crap's not on. Not what about it, just this isn't on, and we are ramping up our intelligence efforts to get rid of you.
Well, Paul, look, to Labor's credit and to the Liberal National Party and One Nation's credit, we have all signed up to the definition of what anti-Semitism is in this country. The only party that doesn't accept the term anti-Semitism are the Australian Greens. They're the only ones that deny the definition. So I'd be looking very closely at the Australian Greens this next week. Labor have been very weak on every bit of commentary that they've delivered on the floor of the Senate in the last week, and certainly in the weeks following October 7's attack. What has happened on the streets of Australia is just mind-blowing to me and to so many other people who sit at home. They may not see it in the flesh, but they are sitting at home saying, this is not the Australia we know. We've got 100,000 Jewish people in this country or thereabouts. The concern on many of those, around the table of many of those families is deep. It is extremely concerning to a lot of those families. Now they won't even allow their kids out of the house without parental guidance or being taken somewhere in the car. They're not allowed to ride their bikes around cities like Melbourne anymore. And this weak excuse that they did not know they were protesting past a synagogue doesn't wash with anyone. So stop with that bullshit, because that's what it is. It needs to be called out for what it is.
Good man.
And we want to see peaceful protests. I don't have a problem with protest, but when we see this signage, it's got to stop. And, you know, when we see a young kid like, I can't stand Drew Pavlo, but when we see him fined and charged for taking a poster down the Queen Street Mall that calls out China, and yet we see all these other horrible signs that are displayed around the country right now in Sydney and Melbourne, something's got to give. We've got to start cracking down on these people. It's horrible.
Let's talk about the Prime Minister in Tuvalu. A couple hundred people a year will be able to get citizenship or, sorry, a visa to Australia to work, live, and, OK, fine, a couple hundred people, and we all know that Pacific Islanders, good, hard-working people, certainly in our agricultural sector, I don't have an issue with that. But it's this move towards what counts as a refugee. Now, obviously, The refugee charter is all about people fleeing from violence. But right now, the United Nations says there's 110 million people in the world who are natural disaster or climate refugees, and the same organisation says that'll be 1.2 billion people in the year 2050. Now, Stephen, have we seen a scenario, and I understand the sort of 4D chess here about China, and let's not pretend that, you know, that the single thing of 200 people in Tuvalu does anything to China, but it's all about trying to slowly but surely pull together Pacific Islands that they look to Australia before they look anywhere else. OK. But if there's 110 million climate refugees and countries like Australia have got tens of thousands of refugees that we take in each and every year, is there not going to be pressure from the extreme and then eventually the mainstream left that that number doubles and half of it's about violence and the other half of it is climate change?
Well, look, I mean, I think this is a good initiative for the very reasons you described earlier when you said, you know, 4D chess. I mean, this is ultimately about Australia having to lift its game. In the Pacific, we've been asleep at the wheel. We've seen, you know, China move in, make extensive attempts to undermine Australia's national interests in the region. You've got the Solomon Islands. Clearly, more than, you know, getting into bed with China. You know, there's suggestions there could be, you know, the dock become a naval base on our doorstep by China. So again, it's always when it comes to dealing with China, don't listen to what they say, just watch what they do and act appropriately. So yes, there is a large, large part of that. The Pacific nations, whether you agree with it or not, Paul, believe that climate change is far more of a threat than you might. But unfortunately, if we want to engage in a conversation with them and try and ensure that we are their partner of choice, then we are going to make some tough calls, like there is an issue here that needs to be dealt with. The government, the US government, most of the rest of the world.
Sure, but what if it's Bangladesh? What if it's Indonesia?
These issues. No, but the what we've said is we'll deal with this on a country-by-country basis. This isn't some blanket change. This is we're dealing with this on a country-by-country basis. And I think that is the smart and appropriate way to deal with it.
OK, but James, do you think that the door's being opened here to the types of people that will qualify as refugees under a very generous intake is now not just going to include war, not just going to include political persecution, but it's going to be climate change?
Well, there's no persecution of these people. So, no, their definition of a refugee doesn't sit well. And, of course, most Australians will be horrified at the fact that we're going to take more people in from a country. I think their average income over in Tuvalu is about $10,000 a year. So they'll come here, be given unemployment benefits, which are almost double that. There's a massive incentive to leave the country straight away. And if you're taking 280 people out of a country of 11,000, it's somewhere around 2.5% of their population every year will actually be shipping over to our country. You know, I'm not the brightest of advisors in Canberra. I'm certainly not the dullest, because Albo seems to have the majority of them, because the size of Tuvalu has actually increased in size. Its landmass has grown by 180 acres over the last four decades. Albo, I'll give you some free advice. Don't have to pay for it. Don't take these based on this whole idea of climate refugee. It's just false, and Australians really, really should be writing to the Prime Minister saying we don't agree with this.
Speaking about 4D chess, the Deputy Leader of the Liberal Party, Susan Ley, who I like very much, her big thing this weekend, and you remember, whatever they talk about on a Sunday is what they really want to talk about, hopefully, for the rest of the week. She says that more should be done to stop the spread of strip clubs in our suburbs. Okay, because it's about the exploitation of women. Well, okay. Now, obviously, when we're talking about, and there's a significant number of people working as sex slaves in the country, in off the brothels, all the rest of it, right? But the strip club, right, generally speaking, you know, everyone's got an ABN number and they all want to be there. But, James, is there a proliferation of strip clubs that I have not seen that have been popping up in the suburbs of Australia? Because I certainly know there's those flashing massage signs at every second shop, but that's not a strip club.
Mate, strangely enough, I've never been one to go to a strip club. I'm not like the rest of the pollies in Canberra that have all been to them. They just don't tickle my fancy, mate. But Australia, look, I know plenty of women that go to strip clubs and they don't go there for the titillation. They go there for a bit of fun and they take their partners with them. There's plenty of blokes that after a footy trip will go as well. I hate to break this to Susan Ley. I think you're going down the wrong path here, Susan. Australia is the seventh biggest consumer of porn in the world. Thank you, Men's Health. Pornhub ranks us at the seventh in the world. So listen, if they're not getting it from an ABN holder, holder here in Australia, all the money for this stuff's been shipped offshore.
All right. Now, I don't know whether it was a work or a home computer that you did that research on, but it'll be a fascinating chat with Pauline when you get to work tomorrow. again, Stephen, I'm not sure where the swell of outrage is here. Again, brothels, people who are being forced to work off... all this very legitimate, right? But the concept that sort of the glittery parts of the Gold Coast are full of exploitation, I just haven't seen many barbecues stop over this one.
Look, I did see the article and I was a little perplexed about what the basis for her concern was. I mean, this is an issue dealt with by local councils, I think. Certainly state governments would be involved. I just don't know that there's a federal government regulation or law which covers this area. I get the sex, you know, wanting to make sure there's no... people
sex
being
slaves.
Brought into the country, sex slaves, as you described them. I get that there is a federal angle there. I just found this an unusual one. I accept the legitimate concerns around wanting to make sure that it's properly regulated, but I'm just was a little perplexed as to where she thought she could take this one in a federal parliamentary sense.
Yeah, we mentioned... Look, I like season, but it's like we mentioned 4DHS. This isn't even Connect 4 in terms of something that I think was a big deal. But anyway, all right, lads. Bold prediction for the week ahead. Remember, these are legally binding. James Ashby, what is definitely happening this week?
Well, I don't know about this week, but I'm picking up that the Labor government are looking to cancel 1 week of Parliament because they just won't be able to get that IR bill through. That's the hot tip, that before this year's out, they'll cancel 1 week of Parliament.
Oh, interesting. Also, we note that the censoring the internet bill, that's delayed till next year as well. Forget their name for it. Realities of the censoring of the internet. Stephen, give me a bold prediction.
Look, I think there will be probably a bigger swing than Victorian Labor would want to see in Daniel Andrew, who's now retired, his seat, Mulgrave. I think Labor should hold on, but it could be a lot tighter than Labor would want to hear.
See, I'm fluent in Conroy. When there's a little gear wobble, like should, there's an internet. Pay attention, everyone. We'll see what we're talking about this time next week. Thank you, lads. Do appreciate it. All right, Merry Christmas, of course, many, many months in advance to your good self there, James. All right, quick break. Back with more. Andrew Bogut, Rogues. Let's talk about politics and sport and how they shouldn't link, but they do. He's a man who calls it out, one of the greats of Australian basketball, exclusive to Paul Murray Live. Bogut played basketball for Australia for the Golden State Warriors, significant interest in the Sydney Kings, but more important than that is common sense, which is why he turns up with us every couple of weeks. And I'm pleased to say you can find his podcast, audio and video form, Rogues Bogues, all the usual places you find these things. Great man, lovely to see you. So the Aussie netball team has a particular way of warming up. Roll the tape. Now, I don't know whether Bruno Mars was anything you danced to with the Warriors, but you may well have had it in your headphones.
Yeah, I'm not too sure if I'm going to watch a netball game, I'd want to watch netball. that's, you know, if I'm going to a basketball game, I want to watch basketball. So I guess congratulations to them.
But this is sort of...
Lost for words.
Yeah, but it's an interesting thing. It's part of the Fast 15. This is sort of the 2020 version of netball. And sports always love to find these ways to jazz up everything but the game, right? Now, okay, you want to muck around with your teammates, fine and fair enough, a certain celebration after, you know, scoring a touchdown, a try, kicking a goal, all the rest of it, right? But sometimes there's stuff that if your teammates said it to you, say, hey, mate, when we go out against the Bulls, let's all do this thing, you just go, yeah, probably not.
And look, I've lived this experience firsthand. When I first got to the Sydney Kings, there was a lot of things done on game day that were not about the game and basketball. And there's still some NBL clubs that do that. Fine, they enjoy doing it, such as playing a lot of music. We try to really emphasise that people are here to watch basketball. Everything else is a sideshow to that. And I think that's very similar in most sports. There's all these theatrics coming out. You see it in the Big Bash and the flames and the smoke and all that kind of stuff. I think most people are going there to watch a game. Everything else should be secondary to that.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of those things where, again, you know, a little bit of razzmatazz, okay, but when it starts to distract from the sport, it's a very good point, which is why the club is so successful. Now, again, in the NBL, somebody decided that there was going to be an Indigenous theme to a jersey. This one was going to be there for the Tasmanian Jack Jumpers. Before we get into anything else, what the hell is a Jack Jumper? I know this is a really 101 question, but I know what a King is. I know even what a 36er might be. What the hell is a Jack Jumper?
I believe it's an angry ant that can bite you. I believe.
Okay, so they decided to go down this route, and then, of course, the artist had issues with all of this. People had issues with the artist. Again, what does this tell you about how sports constantly need to go and tick this particular box, no matter either what the participants or the artists at times may well get reaction to?
Yeah, of course. It was for Indigenous round a couple of rounds ago here in the NBL, and I guess there were some Indigenous groups or some people that weren't too fond of that Indigenous artist, saying it didn't really, you know, bring our local community together in the form of art, and the certain type of art used by this artist was not reflected to the Indigenous people down there. But it just goes to show, I mean, people are always going to find something to be angry about. I mean, we've had issues. I've been firsthand involved in issues at times where there's been smoke ceremonies and there's been different Indigenous groups that have almost punched on because, like, that's our area for us to do the smoke ceremonies in, not your area, not that other Indigenous group's area. So it gets kind of really murky at times. And I guess the Jack Jumpers have just said, too hard basket, we're not going to do it, see you later, and then everyone loses. So it's just one of those things you can never make everybody happy at the same time, and they've pulled the jersey now.
Now, let's talk about efforts from the government who now want to go after toxic masculinity, which means the shorthand for that is Andrew Tate, anything he believes, and everyone who follows. They're going to put in, what, $3.5 million here. Now, obviously, neither you or I are going to go all in on everything that bloke's ever said, but there's a reason people are attracted to it about, frankly, trying to reclaim masculinity, not toxic masculinity.
Yeah, I tweeted this over the week. I just think it's despicable that, especially with everything going on in this country right now with cost of living and whatnot, the government's throwing money at this. I've got two young boys and, you know, I'm proud of their masculinity, and I'll raise them to be masculine boys that have manners and say please and thank you and do all those things. But it's not toxic masculinity. It's toxic people. They can come in all forms, all genders these days, however many of them there are. It can go either way, right? And looking at the studies of, you know, even DV, you see it in same-sex. The rate is the same in same-sex marriage couples. Women married to women have the same rate of domestic violence. So that tells me that it's not just one gender or the other. Yes, there are some violent men, some dropkicks out there, but it's toxic people. So labeling boys, young boys, telling them, hey, you're toxic just because of your gender, I think to me is just absolutely ridiculous and something that I won't stand for, especially when you have toxic governments that are in power all over this country.
Hallelujah, brother. And if they've got $3.5 million to turn around, why not some de-radicalisation programs, which may well affect some of the people and where and how they protest, let alone what they preach at the moment. Thank you, great man. Rogue Spokes podcast, Andrew Bogut. Follow him on the socials because he always makes news and then he has a chat with us as well. Thank you, mate. Do appreciate it. Right, quick break. Back with more special message from friends, four friends of the show in a moment or two's time, and the Royal Report about 5 minutes from now. Thanks for watching this Sunday night here on Sky News. Hey, shout out before us. Tomorrow night is going to be the Libs in Power documentary. Chris Kenny, my dear friend, has been working on it for ages. It's brilliant. Had a chance to see the first episode. You'll see it tomorrow night on the air at 8 p.m. Now, big shout out to two friends of the show, Barnaby Joyce and his now wife, Vicky. They got married over the weekend in the New England region. One of my favourite photos is the unofficial one. Now, the official ones will be up in the Telegraph in the next couple of days. I'll show you those in a second. But how good is a beautiful bride getting around with the rockin' boots and the wedding dress? Well done, Barnaby. Punching above your weight, as usual, my friend. Well done. But again, congratulations to Barnaby and to Vicky. Apparently a beautiful ceremony. Their beautiful boys, Thomas and Sebastian, were there, as well as lots of other parts of family and friends. But all the best to them on a long and happy life together. We'll see you again tomorrow night for another edition of Paul Murray Live. Remember, we're all up on all the socials. Send me an email, paul@skynews.com.au. Here's the Royal Report. Ta-da.